Hey, listen, we're in the middle of the oven.
No,
the baker is heating the oven, and he's going to bake bread. So we're in the next to the end of the verse, right there, the last four words. Milush batsek ad chumtzato. So we don't know milush, and we don't know batsek. So we're going to, I think they're going to be, so I think we're going to see both of these together because of what they mean, I hope. So, Shmuel Bet, Yud Gimel, Pasuk Shmone. So this is a story of Tamar and Amnon. Who were they? They were David's kids. It's not going to have a very happy outcome. But we're not going to read about the outcome. So, Telech. Who was the Telech for? She. She went to Tamar. She went to his house. Achiha, her brother. Behushachev. He is lying down. V'tikach, who is the tikach for? She took. So batzek, these are the two words we're looking at. Batzek is the dough. It's just dough. And then we have this verb, which is lush. And what do people do with dough? They knead it. So that's the verb there, talash. So she took the dough and she kneaded it. And then in a seasonal moment here, she levaved them into levivot. So what are levivot? Pancake. Oh, yeah, maybe they're heart-shaped. I don't know. So here's the verb to levive. And you see that's the verb for making levivot. Okay, so she was there. V'tivashel is what? She cooked them. Okay? All right, who else is using betzek in Bereshit? It's yidchet. What's Mahar? Maher. Maher. Okay. Where did he go? To the tent, to Sarah. And he gives her the command. Mahari. Hurry. What is she taking? Shalosh se'aim. Kemach. Three se'as. So kemach is the word for flour. Betzek is dough. And what is she supposed to do with it? Lushi. She's going to knead it. And she's going to make ugot. Some kind of little cakes. Bread cake. So this is Lushi. All right. Let's go back to Hosea. Four then, and see what is he talking about. Sometimes it's hard, even if you know all the words, to figure out what is the meaning, and this is sort of one of those. Kulam mena'afim. They're all adulterers. Kamo tanur. They're like an oven. We talked about it, right? Bo'era, we talked about burning. Me ofe. Who is burning the oven? The baker, okay? They're like an oven, which is being run by a baker. We know that it's burning, it's hot. Now, we talked about this yishbot from Shabbat. Something is ceasing. What is ceasing? Me'ir. Do you remember what we talked about, the me'ir? Awakening. What he's ceasing from is stirring the ember during a different process. The process that he's not is milush batzek. He's kneading the dough until chumtzato, chamet. During the time, most of you have made bread, you knead it, and then you let it rest, mm-hmm. and it's rising. Mm-hmm. Okay, at that point, he's not worried about how hot the oven is. He's not stirring up the embers, but something is happening, right? The bread is leavening. I think it's not it's going rising. To be a good thing. It's not good. What's going on? Okay, because they're all burning up, and now the ideas are percolating, right? What does it say in James? You know, you don't start just head out the door and go, hey, I'm going to sin. Starts as some thought, right? And you let it percolate. And then eventually it's going to come to fruition in your flesh. Here it is. It's raising like dough. It's hot. But there's no passions talked about here.
Right.
It's entirely in symbolism because the Bible is so polite. Verse 5. Yom Malkenu, the day of our king. In that day of our king, Hechelu from Choleh, going to make them sick. Who's going to make them sick? The princes will make them sick. And what kind of sick are they making them? Chamat miyayin. But what is the chamat? Like heat, okay? So usually we talk about it, when we talk about, let's say, chamat apo, what is that? What is af? So what is this talking about?
Anger.
God's anger is referred to like this. Chamat apo. The chamat is another word for the sun. Because it's warm. It's warm there. Yeah, they're like inflamed with wine. Okay, and they're becoming sick because they're inflamed with wine. Mashach, I don't, maybe we haven't done, but Mashach is on the door. When you go in the door and you have to push the door open. So what is it that's his hand? Okay, is pushing out lotzasim. So I think we're going to see this a little bit. You know a word, some people here know a word, leitzan. What is leitzan? A modern word is a clown. But this root is a scoffer or a mocker. Okay, leitzan is, there are no clowns in the Bible. He's like stretching out his hand like towards to the mockers or with the mockers. And this is what's happening to the kings and the princes. They're drunk, and people do stupid things when they're drunk. That's true, isn't it? Verse 6. So, ki, we know. What is the root for kirvu? Karov means to be close. How, like korban? Yes, right? All your offerings, what are the purpose of the offering? To draw near to God. But this doesn't exactly mean draw near. Like a tanur, like the tandoori oven, right? Libam. So what is it? Their heart is drawing near, or they're making their heart like an oven. It's not a good thing. It's heating up again. Buh or bum. So we did have this arov. I don't know if you remember it. Anybody write it down? Anybody remember? That's erev. Okay. So we have all these erev words that are vaguely related to these arov words. Okay. So it's the fourth plague. And it has the idea of Rav behind it. A greater multitude, it's an ambush. Why is it an ambush?
They hide in the rocks and then they jump out at you. Suddenly, like a swarm.
So what is the idea here? They're heating up their heart like an oven. They're lying in wait. Kol halayla, yashen, sleeping the ofeh. The baker's sleeping all night. Okay, he's waiting for the time, you know, when the oven is hot and so on. We'll see what happens. Boker, boer, burning, ka'esh, like a fire, lehava, I think we have never had. It is a flame. So let's find some lehava.
Shmuel Aleph, Yud Zion, Pasuk Sheva. Who is this talking about?
Goliath, okay, 1 Samuel 17, David and Goliath. So there's an interesting Ketiv Kri, because it's written chet, but then it's corrected to etz. So chetz is an arrow, but etz is a tree. Okay, it's actually talking about the rod of his chanit, which is a spear, the shaft of the spear. And it is like menor or gim. So it's oreg is a weaver. We talked about that a long time ago when we talked about purple. This is the weaver, this is the beam. That's his shaft. And the lehavat of his spear. So what do you think that will be? We've talked about the beam. So what will the other part be?
The
spear head, right? So how does that represent like a flame? It's like a shape.
The shape
of it is like a flame. Mm-hmm. So his spear head is 600 shekalim, 600 shekels of barzel. All right, iron. Nose. Who is the nose? What is he doing? Carrying his shield, the person who is carrying, it's a participle, right? Halech lefanav is walking before him. So we have this picture of the lehava. Here it is the spearhead, Mizmor Kaftet, Pasuk Sheva, Kol Yehava. The voice of the Lord. Chotzev actually has to do with splitting wood, but the idea is it divides what? Lehavot esh. The flames of fire. Wow, if you think about the flames of fire being divided, what do you think about? Pentecost, right? He divided the flames of fire on each on their head, right? Very cool. See one more. Yeshayahu Mem Gimel Pashuk Shtayim. Okay, we sing a song of this. Ki ta'avor b'mayim. Because ta'avor, when you cross through the water, itcha ani. I am with you. With you, I am. Uvenaharot, in the rivers, lo yishtefucha, and I know you don't know, shotef is a big flood. The waters will not flood you out or something, you know, to this effect. Kitelech, b'mo esh, so just, this is the same idea as ba'esh. When you walk through the fire, lo tikaveh, you don't need to know it, you can guess what's going to happen. You will not be burned, right? Because that's what happens if you're in the fire. Lehava. The flame, lo, tivar, here's our bo'er, we've been working on it.
You will not be
will not burn you. So this is the lehava. This is the flame. So let's go back to Hosea 7:6. They're preparing their heart like an oven. They're readying like the same way, karov, the same way you might ready a sacrifice. That's what they're doing to their heart. They're just preparing it like an oven. They're lying in ambush. The baker is sleeping all night. And in the morning, here comes the flaming fire. It's like he slept on it all night. He had a bad thought. He was dreaming about it. In the morning, the thought is going to come to fruition. It's not going to be righteous. 7:7. Kulam, all of them. Chama, oops, it's a rest. They're all hot. Katanur, like the oven. Okay, achlu, they're devouring who? Their judges. What is the picture of that? They're devouring their judges. It's a rebellion. That's right. They're just maybe chewing them out. They say, look, we don't want to hear from you. Go away. Kol malchechem, all their kings, nafalu, they have fallen down. Ain't. There ain't any kore, one who is calling out. It's a participle. It refers to a person. Okay, how do you know that? Because the ain is the negative on the noun. It's not on the verb, right? There is no caller out, bahem, among them, Eli, to me. No one among them is calling out to me. 7:8, Ephraim, ba'amim. He is in the people who, yitbolal. Can you recognize this? Huh? It's a hitpael. Hooray! What's the root? It's like Bavel. What happened in Bavel? Mixed, confused. So that's what it is. He's all mixed up inside the nations. He's all confused. Ephraim haya uga, a cake. Remember the ugot that Sarah was cooking? Bli, here's your bli, without hafucha, without being flipped over. He's a half-baked cake. Remember when we talked about the tandoori oven, we talked about how they bake the bread in the oven, right? And they slap it on the side of the wall. And then so if you're baking, make a pancake, probably is better example. What does that mean, he's half-baked? He's not done yet. The most famous place is somewhere in Esther, v'nahafochu. In that moment, sometimes they translate as the tables were turned. In that moment, when Mordecai got the ring and they wrote the thing that they could defend themselves, everything became topsy-turvy. Mm-hmm. Today, we have talked a great deal about ha-hefech. What is the hefech? The hefech is the opposite. Remember we talked about lefamim ani, lefamim sameh. He's half-baked. He's only half-turned. Some of it he's got, but some of it he is clueless about. Verse 9. There's a bunch of stuff he doesn't know what's going on, right? Lo yada, lo yada. Okay. The first thing he doesn't know is achlu. They ate. Who ate? Zarim. Strangers, foreigners have eaten what? His koach. They've eaten up his strength. Hu lo yada. He doesn't know it yet. Gam seva. Do you remember seva? It's in Abraham. It means old age, but it also has to do with gray hair. So this is a funny idiom. Seva zarak. So we'll do some zarak, and we'll see what we'll find out about the gray hair. We'll start in Shemot Tet, verse 8. Vayomer Yehovah el Moshe el Aharon. Kachu. Take. It's a plural command form. Lachem, for yourselves. Male, malo is what? Male, full. Full chanaf, a full handful. Piach, I'm not really sure where it comes from, but a kivshan is also an oven, a furnace. He's getting ashes out of the furnace. And what is he going to do with the ashes in the furnace? He's going to throw them. Where? Hashamayma, toward the heaven. So zarak has to do with throwing or scattering. So zarak and zera is the word for seed. They are cognate because it's a similar movement. So he's throwing them to the heavens, le'enei Pharaoh, in the eyes of Pharaoh. And what is it going to come down? After the ashes go up, what comes down?
Boils.
Very messy. Zarak. We'll go to Shemot Kaftet. Pasuk Shesh Esrei. What is he taking? The ayil. What's the ayil?
The ram.
And what's he going to do with it? He's going to slaughter it. Like a shochet. Like a butcher. And then what happens? And what does he do with the blood? You know what he does with the blood. He sprinkles it. So So this is also Zarach. It's the same kind of action. Yechezkel, Lamed Vav, Pasuk, Esrim Bechamesh. What is 36 about? Again, he's sprinkling. What is he sprinkling? Mayim Tehorim, cleansing water. Okay, Taher, we're going to see it three times here, right? And then Tehartem, right? I will cleanse you, right? I will cleanse you. Mi kol tumot tame, your uncleanness, your defilement, and also from all your gilu lechem. So this is a funny word. I think that it's a gimel lamed word, right? Well, let's say that it's something round. So sometimes it's associated with the roundness of a tree that's been carved into an idol, right? I will cleanse you from all your uncleanness and all your idols. And there you go, contamination. All right. And I will cleanse you. So back in Hosea 7:9. So this is a bit of an idiom. We're talking about the seva zarka bo. So what is it that's sprinkled around him? He has gray hair sprinkled around him. In other words, he's getting old, he's getting gray, but he hasn't seen it because he just has one here, there. His gray hairs are kind of sprinkled around him, but he doesn't know it, all right? His strength has been eaten up by foreigners, and he's beginning to go gray. Things are not, you know, improving for him. His whole situation is getting old. You get old, you don't have such great strength anymore, right? And he doesn't know it. Why does he not know it? Because he is arrogant. And he refuses to turn back to God. The kings won't plead for God. Anybody comes, the shofet, the judge comes to correct him. You know, they choose him out. He eats him up. No, we're just going to go our own way. And isn't that what happened, right? And this is Ephraim. He's lost. But, you know, maybe by chapter 14, he'll recuperate. Okay, shalom.